Good morning. We welcome you to our gathering of Holiday Bible Church. We're glad you're here, and I just realized I forgot my mic, so I'm leaning into this one. But we're glad you're here on this Happy New Year's Eve. So we will preemptively say Happy New Year. And I can think of no better way to end the year than to be with you in the house of the Lord, praising the God of all the ages together. The God who never changes from one year to the next. I don't know if you've noticed, but we tend to change, don't we? From one year to the next, things change. And most often, at least physically, not for the better. We're winding down. Just as we felt like we were winding up. But we serve the God who is ageless. We serve the God of all eternity, and it is Him we come to praise this morning. Only one announcement for you, and that is a reminder that in the month of January, we are entering into 21 days of prayer. If you did not see these cards in the lobby, they are there, and I would encourage you to grab one as you leave this morning. This is just going to serve as a reminder that we are seeking the Lord specifically, putting a special emphasis on prayer for 21 days, January 7th through the 27th. There is an inherent danger in doing something like this, and I want to recognize that danger. The danger is that prayer becomes something that we do when we're told to do it, or when we have a special event to do it. That's not the purpose of having 21 days of prayer. The purpose is to build in us a pattern that will serve us throughout 2024, a pattern of turning to the Lord in prayer regularly. It's building a routine of seeking the Lord together. On the back side of this card are just a little bit of information, a couple of points about what to expect. One of those, very, very important to mention now. The rest of them we'll cover later. But the one that's important to mention now is that there will be daily prayer prompts that we are going to send directly to you. Which means there's one of two ways that is possible. I'm not going to drop a letter in the mail every single day, so I apologize about that up front. So what we really need is to make sure we have your email address on record. So if you have Breeze, you remember that we went through a couple of years ago, got you all signed up. If you are on Breeze and can log in, go check and make sure your email address is there. If you're not sure what that means, or you don't know if we have your email address, please come talk to me or Trevor, one of us, so we can make sure to get that put in there so you can receive those daily email prayer prompts. The other possibility that we're at least looking into is throwing those prompts up on our Facebook profile, so you can follow us there as well, and that will hopefully get you that same information. But that's what you need to know now, so that you are prepared for the 7th when it comes around to receive those prompts. And then there is a section on the bottom of the back of the card, just some ideas about how to prepare. What do we do now in preparation for 21 days of prayer? And it's very simple. Number one, make sure we have your email address. Number two, set aside time to pray every day during that 21 days. And number three, start praying now. Again, this is not something that is happening just for a 21-day period of time. This is something that ought to be a consistent pattern, a consistent behavior, something that is a priority for us to engage in. So start now. And one thing you can be praying is that the Lord would use these 21 days to give us direction, that He would meet with us in a special way during that time. So that's coming up. We'll begin officially next Sunday. We are here not of our own accord, though. We are here because God has called us to worship Him together. And this is what He says in Daniel 7, verse number 14, and to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. Let's pray to this God who is the great King of all the ages. God, we recognize we are here this morning not because we are wise, not because we are smart, not because we have figured something out that other people have not. We are here because you are faithful. You have called us. You have spoken to us and given us life and will to respond. You have given us faith to believe. And so, God, we are here because you are faithful. And Lord, it's just another reminder that you are worthy of our worship. You are worthy of what we are about to offer you in our singing and even in the responses of our heart to your words. So, Lord, we ask that you would give us ears to hear and mouths that are fit to praise you. And, Lord, fill our hearts with faith and with joy. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's go ahead and stand together to sing of the greatness of God, how great thou art.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God Son not spare me, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, love. truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me.
Our call to repentance comes from James 5:16. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Come to a time where we can remember that we are sinners, but God had a way and he gave his son to pay for those sins, that we can come and confess and receive forgiveness. Let's pray. O Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments. We have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and rules. The Lord our God belongs mercy and forgiveness. For we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by walking in his laws, which he set before us by his servants the prophets. We've transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. And now, O Lord our God, who brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand, and have made a name for yourself as it this day we have sinned. We have done wickedly. Now therefore, O our God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his pleas for mercy. And for your own sake, O Lord, make your face to shine upon us.
O my God, incline your ear to hear. Open your eyes to see our desolations, the people who are called by your name. For we do not present our pleas before you because of our righteousness, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your own sake, O my God, because your church, your people, are called by your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Scripture of assurance comes from Psalm 86:5. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon you.
Let's go ahead and stand together for one final song. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Creation I sing, praise.
grab my microphone. Let me make sure this thing is working. If I step over here, can you hear me still? Is that all right?
All right.
Very good. Our scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 9. I was not quite ready to leave Christmas behind yet, and so we're going to consider one more passage together that oftentimes is used at Christmas, in our hope that the Lord will not only teach us, but encourage us in the year that is to come. So this is our attempt this morning at connecting Christmas with the new year. All right, Isaiah chapter 9, verse number 1 says, "But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born. To us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this." Let's pray together. Lord, you have said that men shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So God, feed us this morning. Fill our hearts with truth that we might live. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The last couple verses of Isaiah chapter 9 are pretty well known, verses 6 and 7. Those are the ones that get connected with Christmas time. We revisit them seemingly every year, but they're worth considering again here at the end of the Christmas season because they are a ballast for us. You know what a ballast is, right? That's what you put in the bottom of a boat to stabilize the boat so that when the waves crash against it, it doesn't flip over. This passage, this truth about the kingship of our Lord Jesus Christ is our ballast. It is our stabilizer through times of uncertainty and difficulty. And so what better time to reconsider them and to remind ourselves of this stabilizing reality that Jesus reigns than at the start of a new year. We all approach a new year, really, I would say we all approach it differently, but there's probably two basic ways we approach New Year's. One might be with great anticipation, right? New year, new start. New year, new me until February, and it's all the same again, right? You're just another year older. The other way, the more pessimistic of us, look at the new year and go, man, I have no idea what's going to happen, but if it's anything like 2023, buckle up. Probably going to be worse, right? We Eeyore the new year. If you don't get that, I feel sorry for your childhood, okay? Now, before we dive too deeply into this particular passage, it might be helpful just to consider the context in which Isaiah the prophet speaks these words in chapter 9. And
Because it actually begins with quite a reversal. Like, if you're just reading through the book of Isaiah, and you read chapter 6, 7, 8, like, it's pretty negative. Like, it's pretty heavy stuff. And so when you get to chapter 9, and all of a sudden there's this proclamation, there will be no gloom for those who were in anguish. It's quite a reversal from what was just said in chapter 8 in particular, where the prophet was warning of a coming menace, the king of Assyria, the world power of his day. He's coming. And he will be victorious over Israel. As a sign of the certainty of Israel's fall, Isaiah was told to name his newborn son. Get this, right? Some of you are going to want to write this down, maybe your grandchildren, maybe your children, as a potential name. All right, you ready? He was to name his son Maher Shalal Hashbaz. Right? It's perfect. You're welcome. Maher Shalal Hashbaz means speedy to the spoil or quick to the plunder. In other words, Isaiah's sons, which he will later say, here I stand, myself and my sons, as portents or as warning signs to Israel of the judgment that is coming. This son, the warning was, judgment is coming swiftly, and it will be here soon. Chapter 8 focuses on two major sins that have contributed to the darkness and the gloom of Isaiah's day. Two major sins are these. Ready? I'm going to give them to you, then we're going to talk about them in a few minutes, then we'll get back to 9, right? Sin number one, they are afraid of the wrong things. And sin number two, they were trusting in the wrong things. They were afraid of the wrong things, and they were trusting in the wrong things. These were the two major fears that God highlights in Isaiah chapter 8. And so, for instance, in verse number 11 of Isaiah 8, it says, "For the Lord spoke thus to me with his strong hand upon me and warned me not to walk in the way of this people, saying, do not call conspiracy all that this people calls conspiracy, and do not fear what they fear, nor be in dread." In other words, God says, don't be like the people. Do not live your life fearing what other people fear. Now, we're not quite sure what the conspiracy was. When God says, don't call conspiracy everything they call conspiracy, we're not exactly sure what he has in mind. It might have been a specific rumor that there was going to be an alliance between Ahaz, the king of Judah, and maybe the king of the north, who had already an alliance with Syria. Or maybe an alliance was being made, you know, conspiracy of an alliance with Egypt or with Assyria, who was coming. And so we don't have to worry, right? Conspiracy. We've got things worked out. But maybe it wasn't a specific rumor necessarily that he had in mind, but more of a general warning of giving yourselves over to these kinds of rumors and conspiracies and plans of man. In other words, the warning is, don't get caught up in living life as if God does not exist. As if God is not in charge. Folks, we live in the era of conspiracy, don't we? Thanks to the internet and the way that it can platform anyone, there is now a conspiracy about everything. Everything from the moon landing to COVID-19 to elections. You want a conspiracy, right? If you want a conspiracy, there's one to be found. There's conspiracy over college football, right? There's conspiracy over everything right now. And what happens, though, listen, what happens when everything becomes a conspiracy? When there's special hidden knowledge behind everything, what happens? Well, what happens is nothing is certain anymore, right? When nothing is certain, we lose our sense of security, and we find more and more things to be afraid of. There's always this idea floating in the back of our heads that there's something going on I'm not aware of, and we're all afraid of the boogeyman. Right, which means now we all have to dive deep into conspiracies and try to figure it all out. And God is like, be careful, right? Be careful, because what that will tend to do is lead you down a pathway that says God is not ultimately in control. We start to fear the boogeyman more than we fear God. God is saying to those people, and he's saying to us, be careful with conspiracies. Be careful, because you can easily slip into a way of thinking and a way of living that leaves God out of the equation. You can start to feel as if he's no longer in control, that not even he is certain. I read of someone, one commentator on this wrote that he grew up during the beginning of the Cold War era. Some of us are not, like, some of you remember this, right? You remember the sirens going off in school, and you got to get under your desk because that's going to save you from the nuclear blast, right? Those flimsy little desks. But he said that he remembered watching people in their neighborhood build bomb shelters, right? And he said, I asked my dad, what about that? Shouldn't we be doing that? And this was his dad's answer. Don, when Jesus comes, the very elements will melt with fervent heat. And until then, you can trust him, right? Isn't that really the right answer, right? Like, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen in 2024. I don't know what's going to happen in election season. But listen to me. In a very real sense, and I'm going to say this, and you're going to get mad at me, and I'm going to explain what I mean, and hopefully we'll come to an understanding. Elections are coming. Listen, I don't care who wins. I don't care. Now, that's in a broad sense. Let me dial back, okay? We've got an opportunity to vote. We've got an opportunity to engage in politics like no one ever before us. And listen, you better engage, and you should engage. There are things that are important. There are things that we can help decide. But at the end of the day, whether our candidate wins or loses in the annals of eternity matters not one whit to the King who sits on the throne in heaven. It will not take him by surprise. It will not alter his plans, not one second. Folks, in a very real sense, whatever's coming in 2024 doesn't matter. Because the King is on his throne. They feared the wrong things. Do not fear what they fear. Everyone is afraid of tomorrow. Everyone is afraid of economic collapse. Everyone is afraid of government corruption. Everyone is afraid of what's going on overseas. Do not fear what they fear. But they also trusted the wrong things. Verse number 19 of Isaiah 8, he says, and when they say to you, inquire of the mediums and the necromancers who chirp and mutter, God says, should not a people inquire of their God? Should they inquire of the dead on behalf of the living? In other words, who are you going to for revelation? What are you looking to for truth and knowledge? Why do people consult mediums? Why do they try to consult spirits? Why do they try to gain insight? It's because we want to know the future. And why do we want to know the future? Because we believe knowledge is power. Knowledge gives us some element of control over what is coming. And our culture is fascinated with the mystical and the superstitious. Why? Because we fear the future. We want to feel like we have some measure of knowledge and control over what is coming down the path. And God responds with a bit of mockery. Why in the world would you seek the dead on behalf of the living? What do you think you're going to get from them? Why would you not seek the living God? Why would you not hear his words? It's just going to draw you further into frustration and disappointment. And so if you look at verse number 20, Isaiah says, this is again through the inspiration of God, to the teaching and the testimony, right? You want knowledge? You want revelation, you want help, you want security about the future, go to the testimony, go to the law, run to the word of God, because the living God has spoken. And then he says, if they will not speak according to his word, it is because they have no dawn. You have no light. In other words, if you reject my word, it is because you have no future. It is darkness for you. And then he says, they will pass through the land greatly distressed and hungry. In other words, they're going to seek information. They're going to seek knowledge. They're going to try to gain control. And you know what they're going to be left with?
they're going to be left with more frustration and more hunger and more emptiness, and it's just going to, they're just going to get more and more angry. You wonder why people are so angry today? It's because we've rejected the Word of God. We've rejected the Word of the living God. We've sought wisdom on our own, and we've found it emptiness. And we're more hungry than when we started. And we're frustrated. And then he says, when they are hungry, they're going to be enraged, and they will speak contemptuously against their king and their God and turn their faces upward. And they're going to look upward, but it's going to be to curse God, to be frustrated with God. And then they're going to look down to the earth, and they're going to look around, but behold, all they're going to find is distress and darkness, the gloom of anguish, and they will be thrust into thick darkness. You reject the Word of God. You reject His light. You reject His revelation. What is left for you? Then utter darkness. Emptiness. Those are the two sins that God highlights of His people. They feared the wrong things, and they trusted in the wrong things. Then that brings us back to chapter 9. Because in our darkest hour, folks, when we were trapped in the darkness and the gloom, when we were frustrated and hungry, having made enemies with God, it is God Himself who came to our rescue. And He dispels the gloom. And the darkness is chased away by the light. And so here we come again to Isaiah 9:1. But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, He brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, He has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shone. He will come with help for the weak. He has come with help for the weak. He promised that a light would dawn. And did you notice who He points out specifically would be recipients of this light? He says, Zebulun, Naphtali, Galilee of the nations. Who are they? Well, they're really nobody. Zebulun, Naphtali, they're kind of situated in the northern part of Israel. In Galilee, northwestern part of Israel. You know why that's significant? It's because virtually every time Israel gets attacked, it's from the north and from the east. Their closest connection, the intermixing between Israel and the nations, what was most clearly happening in Galilee. That's why Galilee ends up with this moniker, Galilee of the Nations. Like, it barely even belongs to Israel anymore, because people keep conquering it. They keep coming in and taking it over. This is where intermixing of marriages is happening. It's barely even Jewish anymore. Which, by the way, if you fast forward to the New Testament, you remember the whole beef between Israel and Samaria? It was because of the intermarriage that was going on in the north, in the land of Galilee, this mixing of the races. And so God is saying to these people who've been the doormat for all the enemies of Israel for all these years, He says to these people specifically, your gloom will be dispelled. Light is coming. And yet this passage, folks, gets connected with the gospel itself in Matthew chapter 4. Because you remember, after John the Baptist gets arrested, Jesus moves to Capernaum by the sea, the region of Galilee. And Matthew said that Jesus moved to Galilee, to Capernaum, in fulfillment of Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1. In other words, He was the light that was coming. The light that would replace the darkness. The glory that would displace the gloom was a person. It was Jesus. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Why? because he came to them specifically. Folks, I think most of us know what it's like to feel trampled on, taken advantage of, to feel like you're kind of on a losing streak that you're just not sure will ever end. And sometimes the darkness feels really oppressive, doesn't it? Feels really overwhelming. The pressures of life become really heavy. But folks, the Lord has not forgotten you. He has a special compassion for those who are weak and disadvantaged. He loves you. Listen, he loves and he saves the powerful and the rich too. But over and over again, it's his heart for those in distress that gets put on display for us in the scripture. Because he wants you to know that you are not forgotten. He loves you. He wants you to know that his power and his heart are for you. He has a heart to deliver you, and he has the power to deliver you. So folks, listen, 2024, don't stand in your own strength. Isn't that what we tend to do? Like, things get harder, it's like, just going to grit our way through it. We're just going to buckle down and try harder. Folks, don't come into 2024 thinking you're just going to strengthen your own resolve to get through. Instead, can I give you another way? Can I give you the way of the gospel? The way of the gospel is come in your weakness. Come in your brokenness. Surrender to him. Folks, brokenness is the pathway to blessing and strength. So maybe your distress is so great that you don't even have the words to speak, kind of like the Phoenician woman who came to Jesus for her daughter's healing, and all she could get out at one point was Lord, help. Lord, help. I don't even know what else to say. I don't even know what else, I don't know where else to go. I don't have any words. All I can get out is help. You ever been in that kind of weakness? You don't even know what to say? And all you can get out, all you can vocalize is, help me. I need help. Church family, that is the kind of brokenness that God longs to heal. Come to him in your weakness. Verse 4, it's like Isaiah was looking around for an illustration. You know, what is this like? What can I compare this to? Then he says, for the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor you have broken as on the day of Midian. In other words, he's like, you know what this is like? This is like Gideon. You remember that story? Israel was oppressed by the Midianites, and it was a heavy oppression. And God calls a very unlikely man. Right? He's like, hey, you brave man, you. Who happened to be a man who was hiding at the time. Right? You're going to deliver Israel. And you know, it puts God to the test, which, by the way, is not something that is being encouraged of us to do. What's being encouraged is, hey, take God at his word. However, God is patient and kind. And he gave Gideon what Gideon thought he needed. And then he pulled together this army of people, and God whittles that army down to 300 men. And through a very unlikely deliverer, with a very underwhelming force of people, God brought deliverance to his people through faith in his promises. That's why Isaiah's like, you know what this is like? This is like when God showed up in Gideon's day. He came to the weak, the broken, and the oppressed, and he brought a miraculous and unexpected delivery that they just had to trust was going to happen. And once again, God is calling his people to have faith in his promised deliverance. But he's also preparing them for the underwhelming way this deliverance was going to come. Because here we get back to the very common, very popular part of this passage. Unto us a child is born. A son is given. The hope of deliverance from our darkness comes in the form of a birth announcement. Right? Not a declaration of war. Not the showing up of angelic armies in hosts. Nope. It's the announcement of the birth of a baby boy. But birth announcements are pretty big deals, right? We post about them on social media. We have gender reveal parties. Men smoke cigars in hospitals. Why? Because babies are born. Maybe not that last one anymore. Right? But as big a deal as they are to us, they were an even bigger deal when it was the son of a king, because the announcement of the birth of a son to a king meant security for the monarchy and security for the kingdom itself. Nothing was more unsettling to a kingdom than when a kingship, when a monarchy would fail. We don't understand this in our day because, you know, we look at monarchies and go, oh, those are bad. Like, we escaped that, right? But to a country who is under a monarchy, for the monarchy to fail is a really uncertain time. Let's go back to Isaiah chapter 6, right? In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. Uzziah had ruled over Israel for 40 years. All of a sudden, he's dead. He was a good king. It had brought this time of uncertainty and concern. But folks, no birth announcement has ever carried such hope and such joy as this one would carry. The hope of all mankind would rest on this child. But notice, the government would rest on his shoulders. And that doesn't mean that one day the child would grow up and assume the role of the king. It is more forced than that, more immediacy than that. It means that even though he was a vulnerable little baby, his kingdom was never in doubt. There was never a question about who would be the victor. It's still a strange picture, though, isn't it? Against all the forces of evil, all the darkness, all the threats of this formidable army, and listen, it is formidable. This army of darkness is formidable. You and I could not defeat it. It is a formidable, powerful army, and against this army, with all of its threats and all of its warmongering and all of its danger, God presents his champion, the one who will fight for us. And he presents him as a vulnerable, very dependent, crying baby boy. The government will be upon his shoulders. And though he is a baby, the outcome is never in doubt. Not even for a second. The government is upon the shoulders of this one come as an infant. Do you understand? It's kind of like, let me paint this picture for you, because I know you're all Lord of the Rings fans just like I am, right? And so you've seen the Two Towers, right? I know you have. And you remember the part in there where the good guys are all, like they're behind the walls and they're waiting on the coming army, and eventually over the horizon, the lightning flashes, and there's this menacing presence, and this army of orcs descend down into the valley, and they are vastly outnumbered. And the war does not go well for quite a while, and eventually the orcs break through the deepening wall, and they're coming in. But there was a hope, right? Remember, Gandalf rode off, and he said, and on the dawn of the third day, look to the east, right? The sun will rise. Look to the east. And the east comes, and Gandalf comes over the peak of the mountain, and there he is on Shadowfax, his white stallion, right? And with him, the warriors of the Rohirrim, right? And they descend, and there is great victory. And it's this amazing moment, right? Force met with force, with greater
force. But yet, imagine if Gandalf shows up on the ridge of the mountain, and instead of an army behind him, he holds up a baby. All like Lion King style. Right? This one turns the tide of victory. And yet, this is the picture Isaiah is painting. Because bound up in this infant is all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. The outcome was never in doubt. The outcome was never in question. He would crush his foes. And by the way, aren't you glad that it says to us? To us. To us, the child is born. He's to us, not from us. Right? We didn't produce him. We're not in charge of our own deliverance, and we're not in charge of establishing or ruling the kingdom that would come in place of the darkness. He's not from us. He is to us. He would be our champion. He would be our king. We could not save ourselves, and we cannot rule ourselves. We tend to make a mess of that. He has come to do both, which means, folks, this announcement is for you. To you, a child is born. To you, a son is given, which means you can move from darkness to light, from gloom to glory, from anguish to joy, because he has come for you. Which leads us then to the question, what kind of kingdom will he bring? What kind of ruler will he be? And Isaiah gives us four names of this coming king. Let's just go through them. Number one, he will be a wonderful counselor. In other words, he will be very wise. Wonderful doesn't mean good, kind of like how we use it sometimes. You know, someone comes to you and be like, hey, this good thing's happened. And we're like, oh, wonderful, right? We just kind of like pat you on the back. That's really good. Send you on your way. No, wonderful here means something more like marvelous or miraculous. In other words, all of his wisdom will be astounding to us. It will not be the same old worldly advice that we just retread over and over again. It'll be something different. Because it will actually work. It will actually heal. Romans 11, Paul says, oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, and how unscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? You know what that means? You know what that means? Can I tell you what that means? That means he doesn't need your help. Who's been his counselor? There's nothing you can add to him. There's nothing that he has not accounted for. There is no point that he has forgotten. There is no fact that has been hidden from him. He never has to move from plan A to plan B. He doesn't need your help. He is wonderful in counsel. Which means you can take great comfort in him, because Psalm 32:8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. In other words, his wonderful counsel is not just for big kingdom-shaping decrees and laws. It is for you, O people of God. He knows what you need. He isn't just going to offer you the same old retread information and remedies that the world offers through its own wisdom. No, he has counsel that can heal your soul, that can satisfy your longings, that can bring rest to your troubled mind, so you can bring to him all your questions, and you should. And can I just say that this is one of the reasons why we're moving forward with 21 days of prayer in January. Not so that we can pray for 21 days and leave it all behind. No, because we want to build in ourselves a more consistent reflex of going to God with our questions, with our troubles, seeking his wisdom above the wisdom of all others. He is wonderful in counsel. Number two, he is the mighty God. He will be a strong ruler. This is no ordinary baby. In him, all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily. He upholds the universe by the word of his power. No one can challenge his rule. He laughs at our attempts to throw off his authority. Psalm 2, he is the mighty God. And I wonder, how often do you need to be reminded of his might? I mean, again, we stand at the precipice of the great unknown, 2024. Chances are, you're going to get older. Conspiracy theories about the demise of our country will grow louder. Your dollars will grow shorter. You may get sicker. But the mighty God is enthroned in the heavens, and he has already overcome the world. So take heart. Number three, he is the everlasting Father. In other words, he will be so good. So good. Jesus will take us in. He will take responsibility for us like we're his kids. He will be a kind of father to us. John 14, verse 18, we don't often think of Jesus as being a father, right? He's the son, right? Which is kind of it's a weird thing in this passage. To us, a son is given, but he's going to be the everlasting father. The son will become a father. And so Isaiah will later say that when he dies, he's going to go down to the grave, but when he comes back to life, that he will have offspring of his own. And in John 14, Jesus says to his people, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. I will be like your father. I will be so good to you. He does not leave us alone. He doesn't leave us to fend for ourselves. Listen, you say, what's the significance of the fact that Jesus was born as a baby? Why is that significant? Let me give you one reason to chew on. It is significant because he is your father. And it's significant because as your father, he knows what it is to be completely vulnerable, to have to cry in order to communicate need. I know we sing that song, you know, no crying he makes, baloney, right? He was 100% fully human. I promise you, that's what babies do. And it is not sin, as much as we might like to think it is at times, right? He was vulnerable, crying, helpless. Why? So that he could know what it is to be desperately dependent upon a parent. He's the one who says to you, you know what, I know what it's like to be dependent and vulnerable. And so I am well equipped to be your father. I have shared in your weaknesses. This is the whole point of the book of Hebrews, right? He knows because he's been there. Because he has been there, he will be good, a good father to those who come in need. He will not leave us to fend for ourselves in the darkness of this world. This is why he says, hey, look, why are you anxious about tomorrow? Don't you know you have a good father in heaven? He knows everything you need, and he'll be sure to give it to you every time you need. Number four, he is the Prince of Peace. His kingdom, his rule, his authority will produce peace. Ephesians chapter 2 maybe gives us the most complete picture of this peace. Paul says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in the place of two, so making peace. And might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing hostility. In other words, the rule of this baby, the rule of this king, brings about ultimate peace through his cross. It is both a horizontal peace, and vertical peace. Those are hard concepts to get, right? Early on a Sunday morning, right? He brings peace both ways. He reconciles us in all of our differences, all of our quirks, all of our annoying differences, all the things we do not share in common, all the ways that we can get under each other's skin. And yet he says, I reconcile you together. I break down all of those dividing walls that create hostility between you. But not only that, I take you all then and I reconcile you to God. I kill the hostility that existed between me and you. I am your substitute. I absorb the wrath of God for you. He brings ultimate peace. John 14, Jesus says this, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Why? Because the King of peace reigns on his throne and in the hearts of his people. And as long as he sits on his throne, as long as the Prince of Peace rules, what do we have to fear? That's who he is. This is the kind of king that he is. What about his kingdom? Let's look at this closing few statements here in verse number 7. It says, of the increase of his government and of his peace, there will be no end on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. Let me give you just a handful of thoughts here. Four thoughts about the kingdom of this king from Isaiah 9, verse 7. Number one, the kingdom is truly inevitable. It is inevitable. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. In other words, there will be no exceptions. There will be no pockets of resistance. There will be no rebellion. There will be no place in all the universe where anyone can hide from the authority, the rule, and the righteous judgments of this king. It will increase forever. And I don't think when it says it's going to increase forever, I don't think that that is primarily an astronomy lesson, right? I don't think he is here telling us that our universe is infinite and therefore the kingdom of God will expand infinitely throughout all time. I don't think that's his point. I think his point is when he says that it will increase for all eternity, that there's no escaping it. There's no pockets of resistance. And I also suspect that it means this. Because he says not only will the increase of the government continue on forever, but so will the increase of his peace. You know what I think that means? This is a great thought for me because I've struggled with this for a long time, right? I think this means that in heaven, when the kingdom of God comes to earth, you will never get bored. You will never get bored. You will never feel insecure or dissatisfied in his kingdom. The increase of his peace will never end. You will spend eternity there and never exhaust the peace that he has waiting for you, the shalom that he has waiting for you, the satisfaction that he has waiting for you. This is quite different from the kingdom of this world, isn't it? At the height of their power, the kingdoms of this world are limited. They cannot fully satisfy you. They will disappoint you over and over again. And inevitably, they will begin to wind down. They lose momentum over time. There is a life cycle to them. They are not meant to last forever. And so eventually, they pass into the annals of history. So it will be the case of our own government at some point. But the kingdom of Jesus will not only continue, but it will never lose momentum. It will never slow down. It will never recede. It will only power into eternity with limitless resources and limitless peace. You will never be dissatisfied. You will never find yourself hanging out in a cloud, strumming a harp, going, man, you remember the good old days? And we get bored so easily, don't we? But listen, most of you know, I injured my eye a number of years ago, and so now I got to be really, really careful going outside in bright light. And the other day, I'm like, you know what I need? I need a pair of sunglasses that I can wear when it's cloudy because my glasses are too dark, and yet if I don't wear the sunglasses, then it's not good, right? Because anyway, it's a whole thing. And so I'm like, you know what I need? I need glasses I can wear when it's cloudy outside. And so I went online and I bought a pair, and they're supposed to come on Tuesday, and I am super excited for these sunglasses to show up. I can't wait. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to get them, and I'm going to put them on. I'm like, man, these are super cool. I'll probably wear them around the house just for fun. Right? But you know what's going to happen the next day? The next day, I'm going to put them back on. And I'm like, man, these are cool. Like, I like these. These are nice. And the next day, it's probably going to be sunny out. And I'm like, you know what? I can't wear these when it's sunny out. I need something darker. And within a very short period of time, you know what? There's just going to be another old pair of sunglasses. Probably lose the lens at some point. They're scratched off. Right? We're bored so easily, aren't we? You ever heard a song and just loved it so much? Like, this is the greatest song ever! And so you play it over and over and over again, and about the 32nd time, you're like, you know what? Maybe it's not so great after all. You just wear it out. Eventually you get bored with it. Folks, this kingdom, its peace will only ever increase. Every day better than the one that preceded it. You will never grow tired or weary or bored or dissatisfied. His peace will expand in your heart for all eternity. It is inevitable. Number two, it is fully guaranteed. Because it is the fulfillment of promise. This is not the government of the United States or the president's seat in the Oval Office that is being filled. Well, that is crushing news for some of you. It's not. It is the kingdom of David. It is the throne of David. You go, well, listen, I'm not a Jew, so how's that good news for me? Well, listen, it's good news because the king offers the blessing of David's covenant to anyone who wants it. You want part in this blessing? Then he says in Isaiah 55, come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me. Eat what is good. Doesn't he sound like a parent here? Right? Eat what is good. Delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live. And listen, here it is. Come to me, and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. Is there anyone who wants to be a part of it? Anyone who wants to be part of that blessing, that love, that covenant? All you have to do is come. The promise is for you. That wouldn't be the case if it were the president's chair or England's throne. Because the good that those offices may do is generally limited to the nationality, to the race. But the blessing of David's kingdom are promised to everyone who recognizes their own thirsts and comes to the king with faith and repentance. Number three, it is a thoroughly good kingdom. Isaiah says to establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. There will never be any injustice. We will never have to lament a disparity in the way the law is applied. There will be equity regardless of sex or skin color or bank accounts. There will be no shady dealings or backroom deals. Everything will be done in the light with full transparency because there will be nothing to hide. All will be right. All will be just. Number four, it is passionately planned by God himself. You see that at the very end of verse number 7? The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. That word zeal, it's an interesting word. It's used in the Old Testament to refer oftentimes to jealousy. It's a passion. It's used in the Song of Solomon to describe the love between a young couple as jealous, zealous, passionate. It's used to describe a warrior rousing himself for battle. passionate, zealous. Folks, this kingdom is not just something God is going to do. The Lord of armies, the Lord of hosts, has an agenda, and his kingdom is just this thing, this one more thing that he's got to check off of his to-do list before he can finally settle down and live out the rest of his days in peace. That is not what he is doing. He's not marking things off of his agenda going, well, that's done. I can finally relax a little bit. No. This is his passion. This is what his heart is burning for. God is not, listen to me, God is not robotic towards us. He's not disconnected. He's not unconcerned. He's not some old geezer just punching the clock, doing his job every day, waiting to get it done. He is full of zeal. He is passionate. Remember the story Jesus tells, or John tells us of Jesus when he went to visit the temple? Remember this in John chapter 2? And he sees the ways in which they've desecrated God's meeting place with man and turned it into a place for the rich to get richer. And so he goes and he gets some leather. And he fixes this leather into a whip. And he goes through the temple and he drives out the merchants. Why? Because he says, this was supposed to be a house of prayer and you have turned it into a den of thieves. Let me tell you something, folks. A disconnected, dispassionate clock puncher doesn't do that. And so when John sees that, he connects it with Psalm 69. Psalm 69 says, for zeal for your house has consumed me. Folks, God is passionately, jealously, zealously building a kingdom for his glory and for your good. We can never accomplish it. We can never bring it to pass. He must do it and he will do it. And it will not be some cold, sterile environment that sometimes we imagine heaven to be. No. Okay, it is established by the passionate zeal of our God. And it will be full of all the things that are truly meaningful to us, all the things that truly fill our hearts and connect with us and cause us to feel alive. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. It's his passion project. He's pouring his heart into it, and you are on his heart. You are written there. The zeal of the Lord of armies will do this. So folks, think about this the next time you're tempted to think small thoughts about heaven or are discouraged about the trials of this life. It's no wonder that Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2, no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. You know why you can't imagine it? Because he's poured his whole heart into it. It's his passionate pursuit. He is jealously, zealously preparing a place for you. And you cannot even fully imagine what he has in store. Folks, this is our King. And this is the kingdom he has prepared for us. And the great blessing, listen, is that you don't have to wait to die to enjoy its benefits. The government was upon the shoulder of a baby boy. And he has brought the benefits of the kingdom and he has brought his rule to you to enjoy today. To be part of his kingdom now. His government is intact. It sits on his shoulder. And the invitation is open to us all. Come, drink and eat. And I will see to it that you are fully satisfied. Now, folks, in the few minutes we have remaining, we're going to gather around the table of our Lord as a reminder of his promised blessing and as a sign of our fellowship with him and with each other, blessings that are ours because this King came to die, to give his life for ransom so that we might be reconciled to God and that we might be reconciled to one another. Paul calls us to examine ourselves before we eat of this table. And we've shared already in a time of repentance, but I'm gonna have the instruments play. And just while they play, give you an opportunity again, because maybe you now need to talk to the King yourself. To be reminded of his sacrifice, that this great King came as a baby in order to die. And what's, listen, while they're coming, what king would ever do that for you? I mean, who do you think you are if you think he would? No king would ever step off of his throne and die for you, except one did, and it just so happens to be the King of all kings, who left his throne to die for his own people. So the instruments are going to play, and after they play through a verse, we're going to all sing together, and while we're singing, this will be different for some of you, but while we're singing, that's going to be the open invitation that if you belong to Christ, if you put your faith in him, repented of your sins, and are a part of his church family, then the invitation is open to head to the back to the table, grab the cups that are there, come on back with them, and then we will partake together. But this is one of those things where there's no pressure, no one's watching, no one's going to call you out for going or not going, right? But this is something for the people of God. To remember our King and the sacrifice that he has made on our behalf. So as the instruments play, let's bow once again before him. Speak to him yourself and be reminded of just what a king he is. Let's bow together. Thank you. And all God's people said, Paul says, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Folks, we are grateful, thankful for your presence here to worship the Lord with us together. And we are thankful to God for his grace to bring us to the end of another year. And we look forward to his continued grace to usher in the new year. And because he is our King, we can look forward to that with great anticipation and with great joy, knowing that he reigns supreme. Now to him who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. I don't know if we have a closing song or not. We didn't talk about that. We didn't. That's fine. Then we'll just say this. Lord bless you all. Thank you for coming. And Happy New Year. You are dismissed.